Thank you, John, and I want to also thank Louise and John Bryson for sponsoring the symposium and Caltech for hosting us. Why don't the three panelists come up to the to take their seats and while I introduce you. And it's both in the comments by Tom and John, California has been a leader in climate and energy policy for decades. From the time of the embargo, which I'll talk a little bit about in a minute, to the continual passage of greenhouse gas emissions, AB 32, and then this summer, the updating of that legislation. And we have people who are here today very pleased working on all aspects of that expansion in it. And it's going to be even more important as the federal government does less for leading state and local policy. This October is the 45th anniversary of the Arab oil embargo, which many say led to the beginning of modern energy policy and programs. And then for these 45 plus years, California has been a leader. And part of this was born out of necessity. I don't know how many of you remember the gas lines, or your children, or your grandparents, or your parents will certainly remember them. But in addition to lines for gasoline, because of the embargo of oil, Los Angeles was very much impacted regarding its electricity availability. At that time, Los Angeles Water and Power found 50% of its electricity was generated from oil, and they had just signed an agreement with the Middle East. So the what the city did was take a voluntary reduction of 10% for businesses and homes, and 20% for commercial entities that they would reduce their electricity, which they did. And the RAND Corporation has documented that from a study in the 70s that we did for the U.S. government. It's interesting that now oil supplies, as a result of the embargo and electricity, less than 1% of electricity we've moved to other things. We still need to continue it. Well, as a result of during the embargo, the California Energy Commission was formed, and that led to the development of a multifaceted program, from research and development to financial aspects to programs and to standards, such as the building standards and the appliance standards, which are still today, which I was at the federal government at that time, and we use that as a model. And California has continued to be a model, whether it's through the Air Resources Board, the Energy Commission, or the people in it. And one of those leaders at the time of the embargo and continuously was John Bryson. He was one of the founders of the NRDC and was chair of the Public Utility Commission when it was looking at rates and demand responses, and then went on to become the CEO and chairman of Southern California Edison. And I'm pleased that on the first panel we have representatives from all aspects of that involvement. We have first speaker will be Mary Nichols, and I'm not going to read the bios. You all have copies of them, and they're all very, as John said, very well distinguished, active people. And the head of the California Air Resources Board, also was in the federal government. There was a recent meeting in Washington to discuss some of the results of the clean air study that Dallas is going to talk about later. And this is looking at policy that's durable and flexible and adaptable. And one of the comments made by one of the speakers, the most durable and constant, has been Mary Nichols. She wasn't there, but it was a really true statement, and we thank her for all that. The next speaker will be Ron Nichols, who is the president of Southern California Edison and is really continuing to lead that organization into a clean energy future. And then Ralph Cavanagh, who joined NRDC in the late 70s. I've had the privilege of working with Ralph on various committees and activities since then. So each speaker will talk about 10 minutes. And then we will have a half hour for questions and answers. So, Mary.